Tonight on CTV News, are squatters to blame for thousands of dollars worth of civil defence equipment going missing? We have the evidence. You be the judge. Community groups take over schools shut down by the Ministry of Education. And Victoria Street clock ticks back to life.
Broadcasting across Canterbury from the CTV studio, this is First at Five.
Good evening, I'm Chris Lynch, thank you so much for joining us. Well, first up tonight, it's been frozen in time, stuck on 12:51pm since the February 2011 earthquake. But today, that all changed. The Victoria Street clock tower officially reopened.
Closed since the February 21 earthquake in 2011, stopped it ticking at exactly 12:51pm, the Jubilee clock was reopened today. Assembled in New Zealand from 142 packages, shipped over from England in 1860, this clock is a Christchurch icon. Melia Dalzell says it's exciting to have this clock ticking once more.
Such a significant landmark and such an important heritage building. And I think for me personally, you know, as a child, you know, I used to catch the Pipinu bus into town and, you know, we'd always come by the clock tower. It's probably that my earliest memory of a major landmark in Christchurch is this tower, and so it's really special.
A time capsule was also put in, including letters from local school children of what post-earthquake life is like. 12-year-old Isabella Lees and 11-year-old Matty Barr are excited that their letters will be read in 100 years' time.
I wrote about sort of what it's like to be a kid now and what I think it might be like sort of in the future, so.
I wrote about what it was like before the earthquake and what it's like now.
Old newspaper clippings found in a time capsule when restoration began has been added, as well as photos from the earthquake and the children's letters. Earlier this year, the mayor put in a time capsule at the Isaac Theatre Royal. She says it's important to have the memory stored away for generations to come.
I think it is important that we put down time capsules for the future, and I love the fact that we're putting back some of the old stuff that was in the original time capsule that was dug up at the time that the restoration was done.
The clock's restoration work began in March last year. The work included strengthened tower legs and the construction of a new internal reinforced concrete structure. Malcolm Lyle looks after all of the heritage clock towers around Christchurch. Having this clock restored to its former glory for this timekeeper is exciting.
Oh, it's always good to see it going again. Fantastic. I was very pleased to see that the damage to the clock was repairable after the quake. I was very concerned. In fact, I was here not long after the quake to check the tower and to check the clock. Because these are my babies. I've been looking after them for a long time.
Fixing the clock wasn't an easy job. No business manufactures its materials, so Malcolm makes the parts himself. Malcolm says it's a bit like fixing a vintage car.
I have to make them, yes. Gents went out of business in 1987, along with a share market crash back then, because you know digital clocks had come out. So any parts for them now I have to hand manufacture.
Marianne Dalzell says a heritage building repaired and restored for Christchurch residents is important.
Victoria Street itself has become quite a bustling hive of activity since the earthquakes, and so in a way it's part of our heritage actually supporting the rebuilt Christchurch and the new Christchurch, and I think that's great.
Joelle Batista, CTV News.
A good news story to start us off tonight. Well, we continue our series looking at schools shut down by the government last year. And nearly 12 months after students left the schools, Marcus Gibbs returned to find that local groups are still keeping some of that community spirit well and truly alive.
Hammersley Park School, the buildings are gone, finally demolished after sitting empty for many months. Earthquake damage and rundown buildings, low pupil numbers, this all contributed to the school choosing voluntary closure in January last year. Just two of the former school buildings remain on site, but they're not sitting empty. Several community groups are filling the rooms with colour and life.
We want to make sure these they're used. I mean, you know, if they're left vacant, they can get vandalised, and so from our perspective, if we can get the communities in there, looking after them, using them, I mean, it's a win-win situation.
The Shirley Toy Library has been based inside this building since 2009. As the school gradually reduced in size, community groups started filling the empty spaces. The Toy Library is a lasting legacy of this now closed school.
It's nice to still be here. We definitely appreciate still having a roof over our heads.
The Shirley Branch is one of the largest toy libraries in Christchurch, providing thousands of toys for more than 200 families. The librarians are grateful to still be able to use the school buildings in this post-quake environment.
There's not a lot of other community facilities around. A lot of buildings have gone with the earthquakes and not a lot have been rebuilt yet.
On the other side of the city, there's another school that's almost been completely demolished. Manning Intermediate's administration block and gymnasium were devastated by fire in 2009. The $2 million replacement is the only building left on site. The rest of the school has been completely torn down. During the day, neighbouring Hill Morton High School takes advantage of the intermediate's gymnasium, and when the last school bell rings, various sports groups take over. Hannah plays for the Canterbury women's basketball team and says good courts are also hard to come by. She's pleased that the community can take advantage of the former school.
It's really good because gyms are quite hard to get hold of now with the likes of QE2 being unavailable, so it's really good to be able to still use these gyms.
In 2017, Spraydon School will move on to the site and a new school will be built in its place. But for now, this gym has become a community asset.
It's good that it's just not just laying to waste like a lot of the buildings are in some places with demolition. It's good that they're keeping it up and running and still utilising it.
Our halls are in real demand. There's not a lot of halls around Christchurch by comparison to what there were before the earthquake. We've got fantastic halls. People are welcome to use them.
Kendall is another school that has closed but has since reopened, this time as the Canterbury base for the Electoral Commission during last month's general election.
Every piece of paper that went out to the voting places emanated from here and came back to here. All the voting papers were counted here, all our staff were trained here. There was just so much work went on.
The public were invited to come back to the school and play on the playgrounds, bringing the place to life again, albeit for only a short time.
The locals thought it was great because the last thing they wanted to see was the place pulled down. They didn't want that to happen.
The Education Ministry says it's open to community groups who want to use some of the empty buildings on the closed school sites. Marcus Gibbs, CTV News.
The Christchurch earthquake of 2011 produced some powerful images of devastation, and who could forget the photos and video footage of the boulders that smashed their way into the RSA building. Well, more than 3 years on, the story of a devastated building has come to an end, Joelle Batista reports.
When the earthquake struck Christchurch, boulders weighing more than 500 tonnes crashed through the roof of the Redcliffe Sumner RSA. Bev Salter, RSA president, got the chance to get up close to the damage inside and watch the demolition begin. She says seeing it now after all this time is devastating.
It's absolutely my worst nightmare. I never thought the day would come when this was going to happen to our club.
Several boulders smashed through the building. One boulder weighing more than 600 tonnes landed on the outside of the building, crushing three cars. One of those was Bev Salter's.
And they smashed into the back of the building here. There was also a tragic fatality on site as well. And you can see the boulders that are strewn around here at the moment. This area was badly affected by boulders after the earthquakes.
Not the easiest of demolition jobs for these workers. There are still a lot of hazards to be aware of. Sarah's Brendan Winder says in this area, although the ground is no longer shaking, it's not safe.
The dangers are pretty apparent over here. The boulders you saw that have rolled down off the cliff and alongside the RSA, and also a few of them penetrated the back and the side of it. There's also a mass land movement at the top, so there's a potential for a landslide off the top of the cliff as well. So two really apparent geotechnical risks here.
For the local RSA men and women, 4 years later, they are still without a home.
No, we haven't up till now, all this time, no. Places we've chased, there have been no.
Christchurch is the only place in New Zealand to use remote control diggers. For the first half of this demolition operation, the workers remain in vehicles. As they get further in, they jump out and use remote controls to finish the operation.
Get further into the building, they'll go into remote control and we'll take the men out of the machine and it'll just be the machine in there getting operated and the chap doing it will be at a distance.
Bev says what she wants for the RSA is a place to call home so they can all move on.
We could move forward. We could have all our memorabilia where we can see it. At the moment, we've got nothing of ours, so... Yes, it doesn't feel like an RSA when you're in a pub.
From start to finish, the whole operation is expected to take 2 weeks. Joelle Batista, CTV News.
We'll ask squatters to blame for thousands of dollars worth of stolen emergency equipment. Civil Defence staff have been reeling following the weekend theft. Emma Cropper reports on the new details.
City care teams are back at Sockburn Civil Defence Base, reboarding up windows already closed over earlier this year. After breaking in through the windows, squatters appear to have taken over this old vehicle testing station, leaving behind a trail of personal belongings and mess, suggesting they've been calling this place home for some time. A spokesperson for the Christchurch City Council says they had been forced to move on after police were made aware of their presence. But over the weekend, the civil defence base was broken into. Thieves pinched almost $70,000 worth of gear, including large generators needing to be transported by truck, suggesting whoever broke in knew what was inside.
The building, you can't see inside the building, so somehow they've had some sort of knowledge about what's been there. And one of the generators, quite a large, weighty one, I doubt whether 4 people would lift it. It's got a hook on it that are to be lifted up by a hayab. So we suspect that there's been a vehicle involved, a large truck or something like that involved as well.
The thieves took off with 20 generators, hundreds of blankets and several aluminium toolboxes. Many of those donated from overseas countries following the earthquake. A major loss for Civil Defence, who had stored the equipment away in case of a future emergency.
We need these equipments. The generators are for lighting, so if we have a community hall without power, we can set up the generator, get light in, and a bit of minimal heating going as well.
Now the Civil Defence team is scrambling to replace the stolen goods.
We don't have the capital funding to go out and purchase that again now, so we'll buy what we can, but nowhere near to amount to replace what we've lost.
They're hoping these extra measures will help keep the thieves out. The City Council says this isn't the first incident of squatters making themselves at home. Earthquake-damaged buildings abandoned following the quakes have become prime spots for squatters, who have also been camping out in the city's red zone homes and buildings yet to be demolished. Emma Cropper, CTV News.
Well, coming up, listen to this, folks. Half-naked dancing girls, over-the-top performers and sexy outfits. Marcus Gibbs reports on that story after the break.
My son's helped me greatly with my independence now that I've got more mobility.
Mum, I've been looking into stand assist chairs from More Mobility. They recline back with a footrest, then when you want to get out of them, they stand you up. You can even sleep on them. More Mobility can bring one out for a free trial. There's even electric beds too. What do you think? For more range and more expert advice, see More Mobility, corner Clarence and Princess Streets off Blenheim Road.
What a difference More Mobility makes.
Blackwall's has a proud history presenting leading vehicle brands, extensive backup and service for a total one-stop driving experience. Holden, Mazda and HSV new and used vehicle sales, servicing, parts, paint and panel, Isuzu truck sales and service, all together in one convenient location. More selection, more value, more quality and more reasons to make Blackwall's your number one choice. Visit Blackwall's today, corner Waterloo Racecourse Road, Sockburn, or online at blackwalls.co.nz.
Located at the foot of the Port Hills, Berrymead Golf offers a spectacular location for any occasion. Make your dream wedding a reality with private use of our green function room, outdoor garden courtyard, large marquee and stunning gazebo. Or for your next conference, enjoy the relaxed atmosphere of Berrymead Golf, offering a private, spacious conference room with special deals to make any break a true break. All with customised catering from the WOW Cafe. Berrymead Golf, 50 Berrymead Park Drive, right next to the Berrymead Heritage Park.
Welcome back to CTV News. Well, being killed at work, it's not something most of us ever have to consider, but perhaps we need to, because if you work in Canterbury, it seems the odds could be stacked against you. Emma Cropper explains.
Canterbury's leading the country as one of the most dangerous workplaces when it comes to fatalities. Figures from ACC show 15 were killed in Canterbury workplaces in the past year. That's more than twice as many as nearly every other region in the country. All of the deaths were male, with one third of them trade workers. More than half were over 65 years old, in line with national figures, which show the older workers accounted for almost half of all fatal claims. But when it came to accidents in the workplace, Canterbury was lower on the list, behind the Hawke's Bay, Northland and the Bay of Plenty, who took the top spot. The government announced ACC levies will be reduced next year. This comes following the release of ACC's annual report, which shows its financial performance is improving, achieving a surplus of $2.1 billion. That's $300 million ahead of budget.
Well, listen to this, folks. Half-naked dancing girls, over-the-top performers and sexy outfits. What does this all mean? Marcus Gibbs explains.
It's a 90-minute long smash of circus, vaudeville and burlesque, and now Empire has arrived in the Garden City to dazzle Christchurch audiences.
Empire is a love letter from New York City. It's everything that is amazing and sultry and sexy about the city, and we brought it to New Zealand to share our love with the world.
The show, featuring 16 performers from 8 different countries, is in its second year. The world premiere was held at Times Square in New York City, and since then Empire has performed in both Australia and Japan. So what sets this circus apart from others?
We've got several rare acts that are actually very hard to find, so hopefully things that people have not seen before, and we sit people incredibly close, so you see some very extreme things and you're sitting and you start seeing the front row start to lean back just a little bit.
To get to this level, it takes hard work, dedication and many months of rehearsal. These two look sleek on stage, but hours earlier they were still fine-tuning their act. Mehmet Bilgin Rigolo was a computer programmer initially, but soon decided that working for a travelling circus was the career for him. For 10 years, he's been performing in some of the world's top shows, and for the last two, he's been a part of the Empire Ensemble.
But after 3 years of having performed, I was making more money doing circus than I was making programming as a freelancer, so I was like, all right, well, I can call myself professional circus artist. Yeah.
Some of the entertaining characters involved with the show are the two hosts, Oscar and Fanny, and the self-titled half-naked Asian dude with pigtails. More than a dozen acts sourced from around the world are sure to wow the crowds.
So we have a couple of Ethiopian brothers who do an amazing foot juggling routine. We have two roller skaters from Russia who do a very acrobatic skating routine.
I really like Empire because, especially of the cast, the talent on this show is really spectacular.
The show is filled with adventurous performances. Even building the unique Empire tent is a feat of its own.
The tent itself is pretty unique. It takes a couple of days to build and a couple of days to tear down, but it has 10,000 pieces, but no nails or screws, so everything just fits together like a giant puzzle.
The Empire Circus will be running nightly shows outside of Horncastle Arena until the 4th of November, entertaining thousands of Cantabrians in the process. Marcus Gibbs, CTV News.
Ashburton is celebrating 150 years since the first settlers arrived. The month-long celebrations kick off this weekend. A plaque for Ashburton pioneer John Grigg will be unveiled. Head to the council website for more information. Well, this week in Canterbury, the region is celebrating its rich history with Heritage Week. Emma Cropper joined local Littleton residents to explore the port town.
Exploring the heritage of Littleton that's been often overlooked by locals. Dozens of Cantabrians have been touring parts of the city's often forgotten history. It's part of Becker's Heritage Week, which is running for the first time since the February 2011 earthquake. Skirt is taking locals on walking tours around heritage sites, currently under repair by their team. This retaining wall, one of 100 being repaired in Littleton. Almost half of these heritage walls built in the late 19th century and before the First World War. While rebuilding the town's future, the team has uncovered treasures of the past, proving one man's trash is another man's treasure, even when it's found decades later.
19th century rubbish, which we're finding, gives us a unique window into how people were living their lives, what they were eating and drinking. We learn a lot from rubbish, you know, what people throw away. So I guess nothing's changed.
These old bottles and bricks found underneath and behind many of Littleton's retaining walls.
We found these are some artefacts that have come out of skirt projects out and about Littleton, involved with repairing the earthquake-damaged red rock retaining walls, many of which were constructed in the 19th century by prisoners who lived just down the road in the jail.
The archaeology team unsure about what was even in the bottle.
In some cases, when the preservation conditions are right in the ground, we get the paper labels still preserved, and that gives us some indication as to what was once in the bottle. So.
Skirt is more than halfway through their repair work, giving a greater chance of finding more lost treasures like this along the way. Emma Cropper, CTV News.
The Selwyn District Council is training local construction workers as the area has been named the fastest growing region in the district, in New Zealand rather. The series of workshops and training sessions will help upskill the district's growing construction workforce and maintain high building standards. Now, the council says it's on track to process consents despite the influx. The next workshop will be held on November the 20th. Well, still to come, we take a look at the region's weather.
Hi, I'm Caitlin, the naturopath here at Staywell Pharmacy. Working with the pharmacist, I use herbal and nutritional medicine to recommend natural alternatives for your health. This can be to counteract any side effects of your medication, general health advice, or natural options for you and your family. I'm also available for consultations. So come in and see us at Staywell Pharmacy. 27 Shand Road, Hornby. Staywell Pharmacy, live well, stay well.
Undergone home renovations? Looking for that special something to complete a room? Look no further than The Hitching Post. Their extensive range ensures you can find that special something. From plasma cut metalwork, to candles, artwork, weather vanes, or even a customised gate. So come on down to The Hitching Post, 722 Marshland Road.
Action Removals, offering short or long-term storage facilities, full packing services, comprehensive rates, all fully insured and with 6 vehicle sizes to choose from. Earthquake repairs? Action Removals pack, move, store and return your valuable possessions stress-free. Action Removals, a family business that has been operating in Christchurch for over 10 years. Action Removals, your one-stop removal service, on time, every time. 0800 222 526.
As we reported earlier, Canterbury has topped the list as one of the fastest growing regions in the country, growing by more than 11,000 people in the past year. With the region's rebuild marching on, the Selwyn and Waimakariri districts remain New Zealand's fastest growing areas. Plus, a local council survey shows residents believe their quality of life is on the way up, with 80% saying their quality of life is extremely good. Waimakariri residents will also get the chance to have their say on their future, with district meetings held next month. The first one's kicking off in early November. Well, now it's time for a quick look at the region's weather.
Good evening, Canterbury. Let's take a look at your region's weather. First in Timaru, Temuka and Geraldine, 15 degrees today. Methven and Ashburton, a sunny day for you, hitting 15. Same for Rakaia there, 15 degrees. Darfield, Leeston and Ralston, hope you've had a good Wednesday. You hit a warm 15 today. Looking at Lincoln and Christchurch, you hit 15 this Wednesday. Over in Akadawa, hope you've been out enjoying the sunshine, hitting a high of 15 degrees. Crossing the Waimakariri district, Rangiora, Kaipui and Amberley hit a high of 15. Taking out the high of the region was Culverton and the Springs and Cheviot reaching 16 degrees. At the very top in Kaikoura, they hit 15 today. but what's in store for tomorrow? In Timaru, fine with sunshine, but some cloud is expected later on in the day, with northwesterly winds developing, hitting 5 degrees overnight and a high of 21 throughout your day. Ashburton mostly fine and sunny, with mild northwesterly winds developing as the day continues. 5 degrees overnight and a high of 23 throughout your day. Christchurch fine and mild for your Thursday, with light winds tending northwesterly, hitting a low of 5 and reaching a high of 23. At the very top in Kaikoura, mostly fine and sunny, with mild northwesterly winds developing throughout the day. 5 degrees overnight, reaching a high of 23. And in other areas around the region, Temuka and Geraldine reaching a high of 21. Methven, fine for most parts of the day, expecting a high of 22 and 21. Darfield, Lingston and Rolleston, hitting a high of 22 with an overnight low of 5. Looking at Lincoln, expect a high of 22 and a low of 5. Akarawa, fine for most parts of the day with a high of 23 degrees. Rangiora, Kaiapoi and Amberley, expect the region's high of 23 with fine weather for most parts of the day. Culverton, Hanmer Springs and Cheviot, fine all day, hitting a high of 20. And looking ahead for the rest of Canterbury, cloudy and cold on Friday with showers clearing later in the afternoon. Snow is expected above 600 metres, as well as fresh to strong gusty southwesterlies dying out throughout the day. Expected to be cold on Friday night with frosts possible. Fine and sunny on Saturday with moderate cool northeasterlies. Mild and moderate northwesterlies for a time on Sunday, with high cloud increasing during the morning. A cold blustery southwest change later in the day is expected, along with some rain and snow developing to 500 metres at night. Showers clearing but skies remaining cloudy till the evening on Monday, with moderate southwesterlies and very cold temperatures. Frosts are possible on Monday night. And mostly fine and sunny on Tuesday with moderate cool northeasterlies. And that's all for your region's weather this Wednesday. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
Thanks so much for your company this evening. Have a great night.
Supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand On Air.